In this presentation, I'll be speaking on elliptical curve cryptography, basically a simple introduction in context of Bitcoin blockchain. There will be two videos related to this ECC, elliptical curve cryptography. So this one will basically give out the foundations and the reasons of why ECC is used in the Bitcoin blockchain. So elliptical curve crypto systems are widely used in major protocols like TLS, PGP and SSH, and these are ECC is the foundation technology for most of them. So it is a proven and well accepted technology, cryptography, in the modern web and IT world. So aim ahead in this presentation is not to explain the complete complex guide to ECC, but to provide a simplistic overview of what complete ECC ecosystem is all about, why is it preferred, how does it basically work, and why is it considered more secure than others. Enabled with few examples that we'll solve and take on. So the complete presentation will be basically moving around these simple math equations we'll discuss, then the groups, and then the modular operations. So let's remember and revise some math equations. So these are basically, in case you are from the science background, from the mathematics background, so these will be relatively familiar equations. So simple equations like linear equation, y is equal to mx plus c. Then we have got quadratic equations, wherein y is equal to ax square plus bx plus c. That's kind of a parabola. Then we have got cubic equations, y is equal to ax cube plus bx square plus cx plus d, and thereafter we have got the elliptical curve equations. That's what we'll be focusing on today and for the next video. This basically is represented by y square is equal to x cube plus ax plus b. So y square, the square part of y axis, is taken on the left side, and the cubic x is on the right hand side of the equation. So elliptical curve is a type of cubic curve. Now we discussed, we mentioned about the cubic curve, so it is a type of cubic curve only, whose solutions are confined to a region of space. So that's, there is a definite space, there is a definite area that is defined wherein these elliptical curves operate, which is topologically equivalent to a torus. Now there are two terms here, one is the cubic curve and one is the torus. So cubic curve basically represents an algebraic curve wherein the curve order is 3. So that is x cube or y cube or any order of equation which is in form of a cube which has a curve order of 3. Then we are speaking about torus. Now torus is a surface having a genus 1 and possessing a single hole. So what does torus actually mean? Torus is basically like a donut, what you see on the screen. It's like the geometrical shape that is referred to as torus. And what genus is? Genus is the property of a surface defined as the largest number of non-intersecting simple closed curves that can be drawn on the surface without separating it. Now this looks a little complex, but in a simplistic manner to understand what basically this complex 3-4 line means is that it is a number of holes in a surface. So like in the donut we had seen, there is one hole, so the genus is 1. So a surface having genus 1 means a surface having a single hole, one hole. So now coming back to the definition, we'll just read out again. Elliptical curve is a type of cubic curve whose solutions are confined to a region, to a definite space, wherein we come onto the domain of definite math field, finite field mathematics. So which is topologically equivalent to a torus. So that was the definition part. And from the equation point of view, y square is equal to x cube plus ax plus b, this we already mentioned, and the condition is where 4a cube plus 27b square is not equal to 0. So this is the condition that is followed in ECC. And now we speak about groups. So why are we speaking about groups? There are peculiar properties in groups which have to be applied in ECC. And why these properties are there and why have they to be applied, we'll slowly get clear in this video a little bit, and then the next following video. So groups, basically from a definition perspective, it is a set for which we have defined a binary operation that we can call addition and indicate with a simple plus. So there is nothing new. It is a complex looking definition, but giving out a very simple message that they have defined a binary operation that we call addition. So of course there is nothing new that we are reading about 2 plus 3. So plus is the addition symbol, it is the operation, and it is represented by plus. And in order for the set G, so if the set is G to be a group, if it is to be called a group, then there are 5 properties to be adhered to, and these 5 properties are briefly discussed ahead. So first is the closure property. Closure means that if A and B are members of G, then A plus B is a member of G. So if 1 and 2 are part of some group, so this is just for an example, so then 1 plus 2 is equal to 3, 3 will also be a member of that group. So that is a closure property that defines it. It is not open-ended, there is some limitation to it. Then we have got associativity property, that is A plus B plus C is equal to A plus B plus C. So algebraically it looks very okay, but when we actually apply it in the ECC, in the elliptical curves, public key, private keys, later on, we'll understand what basically it applies here and why is it mentioned here. Then there is a third property which is supposed to be the identity element. Now there exists an identity element 0 such that a plus 0 is equal to 0 plus a is equal to a. So that's an identity element. So this is the third property. Now we come to the inverse. Every element has an inverse, that is, for every a there exists a b such that a plus b is equal to 0. Now this property is not applicable to the natural numbers because natural numbers are not negative. So this property is basically just to give you basic difference between the natural numbers and what we are talking about. So naturally it is not that every property is applied to everywhere. No, natural numbers are one good example that I immediately can mention here, that natural numbers do not satisfy this property. Then we've got the fifth property, which is the commutivity, that is a plus b is equal to b plus a. So such a group with these five properties is called a abelian group. Now this abelian group, this is just for a mention that any group which is adhering to these five properties, it is known as an abelian group. And then we come to the modulo operations. So in modulo operations, in the normal mathematics, what we see is it is very easy to assimilate. 11 plus 6 is 17, 17 minus 6 is 11, 8 plus 14 is 22, and 4 minus 12 is minus 8. So there is no big deal about it. But when we do it in finite fields with a prime number of 19, for example, here, so addition and subtraction will mean that 11 plus 6 is equal to 17 modulo 19. So it comes out as 17. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with modulo, modulo basically gives out the remainder. So for anything which is less than the prime number for which it is being moduled upon, then the number is the answer itself. So 11 plus 6 is 17, and 17 modulo 19 is 17 because it is less than 19. Then 17 minus 6 is 11 modulo 19. Again, since it is less than the prime number 19, so it is the answer 11. Then 8 plus 14, 22. No, here it will be 22 modulo 19, the remainder is 3. Similarly, for subtraction, it will be minus 8 modulo 19, so the answer is 11. So these are basically, in case you practice for few examples, you will basically get an idea of how subtraction and addition are done. Now we will come to the multiplication part. So 2 into 4 is 8, again modulo 19. 7 into 3, 15 into 4, and 11 into 11. Similarly, we basically multiply each and every number in the usual manner, and then we take the modulo, and then we give out the remainder part, what exactly it comes like to be. So all these 8, 2, 3, 7, the answers that we get are the respective answers. Now comes the division part. So division is, in case you do some examples, you will find a little complicated, but the simple formula is the Fermat's little theorem, which says that a to the power p minus 1 is equal to 1 mod p. So in case we have got 2 by 3, so 2 into 3 raised to the power 19 minus 2 modulo 19 is equal to 7. So these are just basic examples that I have given out here, but you need to practice more. So basically you get more hands-on practice of basically how this modulo works in the computings that the Bitcoin blockchain works on. But why are we doing all this? Why not simply use simple mathematics and do the algebra? Why getting into a new kind of maths? Because this finite field maths, in case you're not familiar, so you might as well be logically thinking of why doing a new maths in case algebra is available. Now, for example, one of the examples, not the prime example, one of the examples is simple computing 0.1 plus 0.2. Let's go to this solution of what do we get in case we add 0.1 plus 0.2. So we go to this terminal and we go to the Python terminal and we simply write 0.2 plus 0.1. So ideally the answer should be 0.3, but the answer is 0.3 and so many zeros suffixed last by 4. So this is one of the reasons defines that there is some limitation to it, that simple computing algebra cannot be applied in basic finance, which is primarily banking on any kind of cryptography or any kind of mathematical relations or anything for wherein the digits play a key role. So if you find out, you need to read about this 0.1 plus 0.2, why is it coming like the example that we had just seen, 0.3 suffixed by so many zeros and then 4. So while you come to know, while you dig a little deep, you will come to know that what are the kind of limitations and why is this happening. So this is one of the reasons. So now we come to ECC. Now this has been a prelude, like modulo operations, they are used in ECC. Then the groups, all these groups, whatever properties I have defined earlier in the slides, so these have to be adhered to in the basic foundations in the ECC cryptographic calculations. Now we'll cover the basic foundations. So coming to the simple world map, so we have got two people, N and C, across continents, and they need to exchange a number. Now they need to exchange a number which is G. So this is an arbitrary number which they want to share over a network on plain text. But
to ensure that it is secure, they have to come up with few tricks. So what they do is that they both NNC at their respective ends think of two secret keys, which are basically will dwell upon further, that these are the private keys. So these keys be represented by small n and small c. So N and C, they are the two guys, and they are holding their respective private keys, small n and small c, and they are wanting to share arbitrary number G over the internet, plain text. So now let these numbers be given some values. So arbitrary number is 2, and the private keys N and C are equivalent to 3 and 4. Now both take the arbitrary number G and raise it to the power N and C respectively, N and C. So what we get is at after this raising to the power, we'll get 2 to the power 3 and then 2 to the power 4 in case of C. So Gn is equal to Hn, and what is Gn and what is Gc is basically 2 to the power 3 and 2 to the power 4. What exactly they come on to is, now 2 to the power 3 we have got, and now 2 to the power 4 we have got on both the sides. So they have arrived at these numbers. Now they exchange these numbers with each other. So 2 to the power 4 comes on the left side with N, and 2 to the power 3 goes on to the right side with C. Further to this, these numbers after being received, they do an exponent by this, their private keys. So 2 to the power 4 is raised to the power 3 further, and then 2 to the power 3 is raised to the power 4. So these are represented by S. So S basically means these both are same numbers. How? So 16 raised to the power 3, and then on the other side we have got 8 raised to the power 4. So what does it basically come out to be? 4096. So in spite of exchanging the keys and then raising to their respective private keys, they have arrived at a common number. So will this situation suffice? Now why is it same in spite of using each other's private keys and numbers, etc., exponential? Why is this same? It is simple. As seen on the screen, user N and user C, they have basically whatever the numbers they have exchanged. So they are simple multiplications. C into N is equal to NC, and NC N into C is equal to CN. So NC is equal to CN. So these are basically the multiplicative properties, the other group property that we were mentioning about, that CN is equal to NC. So A into B is equal to B into A, or something related to these properties. So now we have this G is equal to 2, N is equal to 3, and C is equal to 4, and we have got 4096. So there is a problem to it. So although it looks secure that on the internet this can be done, that private keys, exponential, whatever steps we have followed, it looks safe, but it is a very simple minuscule calculation for any person who has got some mathematical background or who is aware of any tool. So basically it is a log problem. So 2 to the power x is equal to 4096. Now in case we have to find x, so basically we can apply the log scenario, wherein 2 is the base, x is the exponent, 4096 is the product. And this can be represented as x is equal to log base 2, 4096. Again, that is equivalent to log 4096 upon log 2. And then we come at the value x is equal to 12. So this can be derived at with simple mathematics. So even if N and C, they do all that fiddling of numbers from exchanging each other, so there is always a breakage to it. This thing can be easily broken. But now we have also learnt about mod. In case we doing simply exchanging the keys and we apply a mod to it, 2 to the power x mod 17 is equal to 4096. Now we have, in case we need to find x, now this looks difficult because mod as a function, it wraps around. So nobody ever comes to know how many times it has multiplied. So if it is, and the answer can be the same. So an answer can be the same, 2 to the power some value, there can be two numbers or three numbers, wherein in case mod 17 is applied, the answer will get 4096. But then that we'll discuss a little later. For now, we knew this equation in the earlier slides, that Gn is equal to Hn and Gc is equal to Hc. So the good thing is that mod function can be applied on these. So mod function, when we apply on these, is it becomes user n gets gn mod p and c gets gc mod p. So we are simply applying the mod function to the earlier equations that we have come on. So this is basically the discrete log. Now what is discrete about it? We'll come to it a little further. So for now we have got these equations, gn mod p is equal to hn, gc mod p is equal to hc. Now coming back to the original map. So we have got two guys, NC, they have their G to be shared, 3 and 2, their respective private keys, 2 to the power 3 is equal to HN, and then subsequently we apply mod. Applying mod also, we get a similar number, we get a similar answer, 16, 16 on both the sides. So now everything looks fine because nobody will ever be able to find out with how many types of loops the mod has been applied. So there comes the difficulty part. So difficulty has been increased vis-a-vis the earlier one, wherein we simply applied a log algorithm and we were able to find the value of x. So now we have got this mod operation, but still the problem is today's algorithms and machines and computing powers. These algorithms and computing power that we are having, the algorithms are stronger now to find out this solution. So what we have to do is we have to make it further difficult. So this has got two solutions, that the keys, now whatever in the earlier one we got 4096, then we got 16. So these keys have to be larger and at the same time they have to be shorter. The condition is little contradictory to each other. Keys have to be larger and at the same time they have to be shorter. So what does this mean? So while we come to the last slide, we'll basically come to know what does this mean. But for now, we'll simply do some logs and ECC graphs calculations. So goal of exponentials is to calculate the product. So that is x is equal to 2 raised to the power 4. Goals of logs is to calculate the exponent. So x is equal to, this can be applied in the manner that x is equal to 2, 4 can be written as x is equal to log base 2 to the power, in brackets 8. And we can simply find this equation. Then in discrete logarithms, you need to apply modulo operations to this. So log base 2, 8, mod 17. We apply these discrete logarithms. So mod 17, we simply apply a mod to it. So this is the down three lines are basically representing one way of representing how this discrete logs are represented. So in writing equations and denoting functions. So for example, 2 to the power x mod 7 is equal to 1. So this x will have two values. So even x is equal to 3 suffices because 2 to the power 3 is 8 and 8 mod 7 is 1. And again 2 to the power 8, again it is 64. So 7 into 9 63, so that is also 1. So there are two values which are sufficing, 3 and 6. They both give this answer 1. So there is still a chance that anybody willing to know and putting in that much of computing resources to know that there are still two numbers or three numbers or four numbers to identify it. These four can be the ones that can be reasonably help to break the key. So 8 mod 7 is equal to 1 and 64 mod 7 is equal to 1. So both are 1. So the question, this thing is that when we speak of discrete logarithms, we should only be interested in wherein the exponent has a distinct remainder. So there cannot be some other things wherein we find two values or three values for getting that modulo remainder. So that if the modulus p is a prime number, what we are applying all these equations over prime numbers, there are certain base values which generate distinct remainders for different exponents. So this might be a little confusing, but from the table next you will be able to appreciate what does this mean. Now we come to the equation ax mod 7, where x is equal to 1 to 6. So that is always p minus 1. So here prime number is 7, so we get 7 minus 1 is equal to 6, and we prime it over 7. So the column A represents 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 numbers, and these numbers we basically put in all these across A1 mod 7, A square mod 7, A3 mod 7, A4 mod 7, etc. till A6 mod 7, and we calculate all these remainders that we get. So this interesting thing that you get here is that in rows 1, 2, 4 and 6, rows 1, 2, 4 and 6, in these rows, you can see there is some similarity that exists. So they are not distinct. So for example, A is equal to 1, the row 1, the remainders are all 1. Similarly, in 2, we have got remainders as 2, 4, 1, 2, 4, 1. And in the row 4, we have again 4 to 1, 4 to 1. Then we in row number 6, we have got 6, 1, 6 and then 1, 1, 1. So all the numbers are not existing from 1 to 6. But there are two rows at the same time, 3 and 5, which are absolutely discrete. So they do not have any got repeats. And there the remainders are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So here we observe that for values, for the values of A, which are 3 and 5, all distinct values are deduced. So 3 and 5 become special. Now 3 and 5 numbers, they are known as the generators or primitive roots, or they are also called primitive elements and denoted by alpha. And they are called generator because applying the multiplication operation on this alpha values gives all elements in the discrete group. That means when we applied this alpha, the generator point 3 and 5 on these prime number that we had earlier taken on, the remainders were discrete. All the elements of the set 1 to p minus 1 were deduced. Then another interesting thing is that it will never give in decimals or fractions, 17.0277, etc. So these things will never be seen, the fractions, the decimals, etc., the rounding off, etc. So these numbers will always be rounded off numbers, so there will be no decimals or fractions. So to calculate 4 raised to the power 17 mod 19, so this is relatively easy. You can do it on any calculator or any big end calculator. So you'll be able to find out that 4 raised to the power 17 mod 19 is 5. So it is an absolutely easy one. But to calculate the opposite, 17, while we apply that equation that we had come onto the seen in the earlier slide, so 17 is equal to 4 raised to the power x mod 19. So this is going to be difficult. X cannot be found. And as the value of mod, it is seen that as the value of mod keeps increasing, the difficulty keeps getting very complex. So it becomes more and more difficult to find that x. So this is another property that comes with the discrete logs is, when suppose for example we have got alpha is equal to 3 and we have got p, the modulus prime number, as 7, and the discrete group again is 1 to 6, so that is p minus 1. So in case I calculate 3 raised to the power 1 mod 7 and so on, you see that 3 raised to the power 1, 3 raised to the power 2, 3 raised to the power 3, we go on like this. So there is a sequence which is occurring. So that is 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, 1, 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, 1, 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, 1. So this is the cycle. Now cycle is, again there is a distinction to it, distinction in the sense that all the numbers 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, these are the repeats, the cycle. But whenever 1 happens, whenever 1 occurs, that means it is the turnaround point for the counter loop to again begin, the loop to again begin. The loop is the cyclic loop point. One is the loop point basically. So loop point is where the remainders again start occurring in the same manner. 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, 3, 2, 6, 4, 5, and 3, 2, 6, 4, 5. So this goes on. So this is again another property known, this is as a cyclic group of generator alpha and 1. Now we come to ECC. So whatever we have discussed till now, the modulo operations, the groups and the discrete logs, etc. So now we discuss about what exactly, how are they applied. So ECC curve, it looks like this. Now we consider two points, A and B. We draw a line, simply A to B, and we extend it further. It meets at C. Now from C, we drop a perpendicular down and it comes down and meets the curve opposite on the mirror side as C dash. Now from C dash we make a line to A. This meets the graph downside, and from there a perpendicular is drawn again to the top curve wherein it meets at D. Now from D what happens is we again do the same thing. We at D we draw a line from A to D which again goes further, meets the curve at E. We again drop a perpendicular which forms down at E dash, and from E dash we again make another line to A which meets another point as seen on the slide, and it goes again and it makes another point F. So this cycle goes on from A. It started with A to B, B to C, then C to C dash, C dash to A. In between it intersected the curve and we got the point D. D again we joined from A to D, extended it to E. From E again we got down, we got dropped down a perpendicular and we got the point F. So this cycle that is on, it goes on. Now why is it going on and what does it mean? So if we represent this in maths, so the simple equation will be Nx is equal to E, where basically x is x dot x dot x dot. Now just correlate this operation, the number of times that modulo we do, we are unaware. Similarly in elliptical curves, we will never be able to know, we will never be able to find out that how many times the loop has been run in the ECC curve, that dropping line that from E to from C to C dash and then from E to E dash down and so on, whatever, how many times this has been run. So it becomes very difficult to be found. So from the first equations that we discussed in the slides, it was like this, HCN is equal to GCN. We had this multiplication of 4 into 3 and then we applied the GN mod P, wherein also we defined a problem that algorithms can basically break or make it easier for the cyber criminals to crack the key. But then elliptical curve Diffie-Hellman for last about 30-40 years, this has not been broken and this is going pretty strong and very stable, being used in most of the protocols that earlier I had mentioned, like TLS, etc. So we get this NG is equal to HN and CG is equal to HC. So instead of the earlier ones, so now we got HN and HC got two values which are basically the dot products of N and G, C and G, the private key into the generator point and C into the generator point. So coming back to the same graph, we have this G is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, c is equal to 4, ng is equal to hn. Simply they exchange again these keys exactly in the same manner that we had discussed earlier, and they are basically able to come out with a solution with a much reduced digit length. Now coming back to one slide that I had given out earlier, wherein I mentioned that keys have to be larger and keys have to be shorter. Now this we'll discuss it again in little more detail in the next video. For now you see the summary of things, like SEC is a standard. It is the standard which basically defines a number of constants and number of standards like SECP 192 K1 etc. And of this, SECP 256 K1 is used for the Bitcoin. So it is a 256 elliptical curve key length. But the interesting thing is all these key lengths that I have defined here, 192, 224, 256, 512, the equivalent RSA key length, you see they are about 10 times, 15 times, they are on the higher side. So while in the computing world, we are using mobiles, handheld devices, we would always look for the shortest key length and the highest security, and ECC has been able to give out that. So ECC with a much shorter key length, so instead of 1536 we have got 192, instead of 2048 we have got 224, so basically it is about 10 times shorter and providing the same security as RSA. So that is one of the most interesting features of why ECC is being so widely used. So this presentation basically gave an overview of what how the basically the ECC works and how the mechanics works behind with the help of modulo operations, the group properties, etc. So thanks for watching, and if you have any questions or queries to inquire, you are requested to please comment in the section and like and subscribe as you wish. Thank you so much. Hope I am able to do some justice. Thank you.